Most of the time, when you add saturation to your image, it looks like this. But when you think of the saturation used in Hollywood films, it looks more like this. In this video, I'll show you how to do both, and we'll cover 5 more ways to add saturation. We'll analyze and understand how and why each technique produces different results, and I'm also going to be rating the visual result we get from 1 to 5. So today I'm working with a clip from Blackmagic Pocket Cinema 6K Pro, and I've already applied an IDT that takes us into DaVinci Wide Gamut and DaVinci Intermediate, and then straight after that we have an ODT that takes us back out to Rec 709 Gamma 2.4, as this is our target color space for web deliveries and what my monitor is calibrated to. Since our main focus is to evaluate different saturation techniques, I've already created a simple look in the next grade version that gives us a better starting point. There is nothing exciting going on in this compound node, just simple curve adjustments, so we won't be diving into these now. So without further ado, let's start with method number 1, saturation slider. That's right, we're gonna start with our basics first. So the saturation slider is right down here in our primary section, and it's really easy to access if you're on the micro and mini panel, as there is a dedicated knob for it. Let's open up the scope so we can see what's happening to our vector scope and our waveform as we're increasing saturation. Let's increase it to say 64 and observe what's happening on the vector scope. Do you notice how the entire signal is getting stronger in a linear way? So all the hues are getting more saturated by equal amounts. But there is one more thing happening, and let's pay attention to our waveform. As I enable and disable the node, do you notice how the brightness is getting increased as we push the saturation value further? So we're not only making the hues more saturated, but we're also making them brighter. And that's because this tool operates in the RGB color model. Now, what's important to remember about the RGB model is that if we increase the intensity of each channel to its maximum, we're gonna hit the values of 255 for each channel, and the visual result we're gonna get is pure white. Let's put this into practice. First, I'm going to turn on Show Picker RGB Value by right-clicking on the viewer, and I'm going to start increasing offset until the only color I can see is white. Now, if we hover over the viewer, we're going to see the values are indeed 255, 255, and 255 for the R, G, and B channels respectively. And this is how the normal saturation slider relates to its color model. By raising saturation, we're essentially adding information to the RGB channels and therefore raising the brightness of the hues. Let's grab a still of this so we can compare it later on. Now let's rate the result we got using this approach. My rating would be 2 points. And the reason why I don't love the saturation slider is because it brightens the colors of our image, and so the visual result we get looks a bit garish and digital to me. It might work when used sparingly, but it's definitely not my go-to tool when I want to increase saturation. Now let's jump to method number 2, RGB Mixer. First, let's create a new grade version and reset the node. The way to increase saturation with the RGB mixer is by raising the red channel in the red output, the green channel in the green output, and by doing the same with the blue output. The added saturation is way too much, so to fix this, you can dial it back to taste by turning down the key output gain. Now, do you notice how the vectorscope and waveform react to our correction? The trace in the vectorscope is getting equally bigger, so the hues are getting a linear push in saturation. And if we look at the waveform, the hues are getting brighter again. Let's switch back to our previous grade version and compare. Do you see a difference? No? Well, that's because the result is identical. Both the RGB mixer and the saturation slider in primaries use the same math. So the result we're gonna get is going to be the same regardless of which method you use. And if you're wondering, then why the heck are you showing it to us? Well, it's because this is a technique I've seen online, so I just wanted to demystify it because I'd like you to be able to make informed decisions about which tool to reach for when you want to achieve a specific result. If I had to rate the RGB mixer as a tool for adding saturation, I'd give it 1 point. And the reason is quite simple. It's too many steps that essentially get you the same result if you were to use the saturation slider. Now let's jump to the next one. Color boost. Again, let's create a new grade version and reset the node. Color boost is located down here in your primaries, and it's easily accessible via a dedicated knob on the micro and mini panels. Let's see what happens when we start raising its value. Pay attention to the vectorscope. Do you notice how the signal towards the middle of the vectorscope, hence the lower saturated parts of the image, are getting more of a push, and what's already saturated barely gets affected? If you come from Lightroom, I think this would be the equivalent to the vibrance slider. So if you're looking to enhance the hues that feel muted in your image, then this would be the tool to reach for. So the rating I would give to Color Boost is 4 points. I think this is a great tool when used sparingly. I find that values around 3 to 4 give me a really subtle yet a nice result when I'm looking to increase the vibrancy of my images. Moving on to the next tool.
HDR Palette Saturation. Let's make a new grade version and reset the node. Now, if we open up the HDR color wheels underneath the global wheel, we'll see a slider for exposure and saturation. Let's start increasing sat and evaluate the vectorscope and waveform as we do. You notice how the hues are actually getting darker, and we can see this in the waveform. And the operation doesn't seem to be linear. If you pay attention to the yellows over here and the red over here, you're gonna see how those hues specifically are really noticeably getting much darker compared to the regular saturation in primaries and the RGB mixer technique as well. And this is because the math behind the HDR wheels is different compared to the primaries. The corrections made with the HDR wheels are more technically accurate. It's as if you're controlling the image within your camera. And if we were to compare this to the regular saturation we did in grade version 1, we're gonna see a big difference in how her dress, for example, is getting treated, the skin tones as well. They look so much better with the HDR saturation. And obviously, I think what's gonna be most striking is how the yellows and the reds back here look like.
So if I had to score HDR saturation, I'd give it 5 points. This is definitely my go-to whenever I'm doing my primary adjustments and look development. I really think that the result speaks for itself. I also like how easy and quick it is to switch to the HDR palette and access it. Now let's jump to method number 5.
HSV saturation. I'm sure most of you might be familiar with this technique, but let's set it up and see how it works. I'll create a new grade version and reset the node. Let's change the color space of the node to HSV and disable channel 1 and channel 3. So channel 1 stands for hue, channel 2 is for saturation, and channel 3 controls value. Today we're only interested in saturation, so that's why we're only keeping channel 2. If we want to increase the saturation just in the highlights, we can do so by increasing gain. And if we want to target the mid-tones, we can push up the gamma. One thing to remember is to not touch your lift or offset. If you adjust those, you'd be offsetting your black point and you're gonna introduce artifacts and unwanted hue shifts in your image. Now, if you want to make much more local adjustments, you can use your custom curves and get very specific with which area of your image gets an increase of saturation. If I wanted to target just the lower mids, for example, I can add a couple of points, I'll lock them to their default position by holding down Alt on my keyboard, and then I'll create a new point in between them and start increasing. I would suggest that you use this technique with caution. Do keep an eye out for artifacts and breakage, because these can occur when you've pushed too much, so don't use this technique heavy-handedly. But I'm going to keep my adjustments broad, and in this case I'll push up gamma and gain and I'll park them here. If we analyze the waveform, we'll see that similarly to the HDR saturation, in HSV increasing saturation decreases the brightness of the hues, so the result we get is much more pleasing.
So my rating for HSV saturation is 5 points. I think this is a great way to tackle saturation. I think the result looks really filmic and I personally use it a lot. I would recommend that you save the HSV node as a power grade or build it into your fixed node tree so you don't have to set it up every time you need it. Now moving on to method number 6.
Lab saturation. We're already in the realm of exploring different color models, so let's check out how we can use LAB. Let's create a new grade version and reset the node. In LAB, L stands for luminance, the A channel is where colors from green to red live, and in the B channel we have blue to yellow. The middle grade point in LAB is at 0.5, and you'll understand why this is important in a bit. I'll change the color space of my node to LABCIE and I'll turn off channel 1. As a reminder, channel 1 is the L, which stands for luminance. If we increase the contrast between the A and B channels equally without affecting the neutrals, we would see an increase in saturation. And the way to make sure our neutrals stay intact is to set the pivot point to the middle gray value that we now know is 0.5. If this number is set to anything different, we'd see an offset in the balance of our image. Now let's increase the contrast and evaluate what's happening to our scopes. We can see how some of the hues are getting darker in the waveform, for example the reds back here, and the signal in the vectorscope is increased in a non-linear way. If we compare this to our previous grade version, which was in HSV, we're gonna notice a big difference in the luminosity of the hues. In LAB, the colors look much brighter, whereas in HSV, they feel deeper with more density. So the rating I would give to LAB saturation is 3 points. Personally, I'm not a fan of how it affects skin tones. I wish it added more depth and a decrease in luminance, similarly to what we see in HSV and saturation in HDR. But it could work well depending on what you're trying to achieve, so I do encourage you to try it out on a variety of footage and decide for yourself. Now let's move on to the final saturation technique. CST saturation. You may be wondering, how the heck would you add saturation with a CST? But bear with me and let's see how we can use a CST creatively. Let's create one final grade version and reset the node. I'll search for Color Space Transform in the Effects tab and let's apply it to the node. I'll change my input color space to DaVinci Wide Gamut, and for output color space I'll select Rec 709. Let's turn off tone mapping and set gamut mapping to saturation compression. These two controls allow us to set a maximum limit on the saturation, and the knee controls at what point do we start cutting off saturation. I'm going to dial these back to taste so that the highly saturated reds and yellows don't get oversaturated beyond the gamut limitations of Rec 709. The effect is still too strong, so I'll dial it back further by decreasing the key output gain. Now let's analyze the scopes to understand what is happening to our image. We can see that the signal on the vectorscope is getting a stronger increase in the middle, so the least saturated parts are getting more of a push, similarly to what we saw with color boost. But the luminosity of the hues is getting an increase as well, and we can see this on the waveform. One caveat is that this technique most likely is not technically accurate because it is a technical transform, but I personally think that if the result looks good on my screen and there is no artifacting going on, I'm gonna use it. So the score I would give to CST saturation is 3 points. What I like about this approach is that the increase we get is not linear and we see a boost in muted parts of the image. I would definitely use it sparingly though. I find that a key output gain of about 0.2 produces pleasing results. Now let's see all 7 techniques in full screen. What do you think? I'm keen to hear which techniques you're already using in your workflow, and are there any new ones that you haven't tried out? Let me know in the comments below. As always, I hope you enjoyed this video and you learned something new. If you did, please don't forget to leave a like and subscribe to the channel.